episode 16. I'm your host, Sapna Malhotra. Remember when you were 16? The whole house was abuzz with only one discussion. In fact, just one question. What do you want to do? What subjects do you want to take in 11th grade? Do you have a plan? You definitely need to have a plan. Remember all those discussions? I think we're all familiar with that. We all lived it. And some of us are living it with our children now. But there is a new twist to the angle. Because sometimes the child stands up and says, look, I don't want to study in India. I want to go abroad. And that's where the planning goes the next level. Today on Desk Doodles, we have someone who's going to talk about all these how and when. But the question still looms, why? She's been an educator for the past 17 years. She has been the vice principal of one of the most prestigious schools in Bangalore, Greenwood High International School, for the past 8 years. Currently, she's working as the principal at Nalapad Academy. I'm so happy to welcome Mrs. Kavita Sinha. Welcome to Desk Doodles.
Hi, everyone. And Sapna, you've been very enthusiastic in introducing me. You are absolutely right. 17 years in international curriculum and 29 years as an educator. Old heart. And the question which you have brought as an episode is so, so apt.
Right.
If you look at my own journey, when I was 16, I don't think I thought I would be a teacher, and that too, a very passionate teacher. Right. I was all heading towards management because that was a new thing at that time. And I thought, okay, if not management, it could be IAS officer, but never a teacher. Right. And what actually turned the wheel in favor of teacher was my mother.
Wow.
She's the one who inspired me. And she said, look, you know, a teacher makes a doctor, an engineer, an IAS. So why don't you try? Because you're a natural teacher. I said, why do you say so? And then she related one incident and said, look, when you were a little girl, I have watched you coming back from school, draping a sari around and using the house doors with a chalk to write all you had learned. So looks like it's there in you. Why don't you try?
Right.
At 16, of course, I did not give it in. You know, as usual, I said, no, I have to fly from a little colliery, a town, Dhanbad, and I had to move ahead to look for greener pastures and a better university. I tried doing my graduation, and I did my graduation from Patna University. Very early in my life, I got married, but I did not stop studying. So I did my graduation, my master's in business management and finance. I did my MA in political science and international relations, and I went ahead doing BA. And most recently, I also completed my CSML course from Harvard Business School. So learning is something which I have not stopped.
Wonderful.
And I have realized, if you want to be a good teacher, you need to be a good learner.
Why is there an exodus of Indian students to pursue undergrad studies abroad? That is the big question for you.
I mean, we have fantastic institutions in India. But what is pushing them? And when I look into this, I realize first is the tough competition of getting into IITs and very, very few reputed institutions.
True.
The brightest and the brightest kid does not find a place. And then they think, why should I just grind myself into IIT and why not try into some good institutions abroad? Secondly, the pressure of, you can say, to earn more. Students have realized, because this has become a global platform, and that too because of the technology, they are now connecting themselves with students from different countries. And they have realized, why should I just do engineering? Why should I do just medical? Why can't I do computer science with entrepreneurship? Why can't I do engineering with music? And then they start searching and they realize abroad some good institutions are giving them. Now, the question arises, is it so easy? Does the journey start at the age of 16? Sapna, let me tell you, it doesn't start.
It doesn't.
and it doesn't start, and it is not the onus of only parents. It's a triangle.
Yeah.
The student, the parent, and the school. All three have to work together. And I say 16 is late.
Late.
Job 13, you should start thinking. Yeah. Where is my profiling? Where is my call? People say, no, it's too young to decide. Yeah, it's young to decide, but not young to prepare.
Right.
I always say it's young to decide, but you can start your preparation. When we visit our grannies or we visit any place during our summer holidays, those visits should be a learning exercise. And when that becomes a learning exercise, the student starts exploring and then starts thinking from that early age. College choices comes later.
Yeah.
First, you have to do the exercise of actually looking at what are your interests, what are your hobbies, what really excites you. When all those questions are there in your mind, then you get into the basic of, you know, what I need to do. Now, basically, if you ask me, there are a lot of international curriculums, there are national curriculums, and everybody's confused. If I do IB, I fly to US and UK. If I do Cambridge, I fly. If I do CBSE, I cannot. No, I don't believe. Curriculum does not decide your passion. What decides your passion is what have you thought from the early stage. The money required for going, the fees, all this is secondary. The first thing is your passion. Do you want to be different? Right, Sapna, don't you think?
I think also what we said earlier on, that the flexibility that the children get. See, like we were saying, that when we are 16, forget 16, even I think at 18, we really don't know what we want to do sometimes.
Absolutely.
And I think when we talk about India, that's what we really need to decide, whether we want to go into engineering or we want to go into medicine. And there are these two boxes that we have to somehow kind of fit in. Whereas abroad offers those children that kind of space, that it gives them those 2 years to kind of discover themselves, what I really want to do. And that's, I think, one of the reasons that the big question that I had for you today was that the exodus of Indian children for their undergrad studies abroad answers that, because they kind of get that 2 years of gap to figure out what they want to do. And
the first thing is, every student has some strengths, some weaknesses. Now, what happens when you have flexibility of curriculum, you can actually enhance your strength and work on your weaknesses. Whereas in a curriculum in India, what happens that in 8th standard itself, you need to decide science, arts, comms. Thankfully, the draconian issue is out, the law is out, and after 32 years, I believe we have a new education policy. It will take some time, but that policy has a lot more, which is skill-based. Because we have to look into it that now students are not looking at being just the employees. They are looking at a bigger goal, them to actually pursue their hobbies and passion. That is one of the biggest reasons that children want to go and study abroad. Secondly, there's also, you can say, it's not free lunch. When people are paying huge amount of fees for studying abroad, they also get closer to immigration, closer to getting a permanent residency, closer to getting citizenship in big countries. And then you say, ma'am, why they want citizenship? It's the quality of education and life.
Yeah, I was going to come to that question for you after, once we talked about it, because that, I think we definitely need to look into the reasons why. And the biggest one is that we definitely need to look into our higher education in India. And what is it? How can we just make it, you know, attractive enough for our children to stay back and not go abroad, which we really need to look into.
It's the most, you can say, most important question right now is what we need to do. First is ease of admission. Why is it that the admission is so tough that you need to go through the complete 1 year training under, you know, certain set institutes to get into these
Absolutely.
Programs? Why one test decides it all? Why is it not cumulative progressive result and gives admission, which happens abroad. Why can't we do it?
Absolutely. And it's also, I feel somewhere that all, I mean, children are all intelligent. They have all different intelligences, right? Absolutely. And when you make them sit for a common entrance exam, and it is the stress of that particular day, sometimes the child might not be able to perform under that pressure, might not be able to take it. And then that kid, poor thing, has to sit back the whole year to take it the next year. And that's just for...
Sapna, you're so right. You're nailing it. What I'm trying to say is, why one exam and deciding? Why not the progression from 9th standard? Absolutely. Abroad, they judge you on your 9th standard exam, on your 10th standard performance, on your 11th standard. And in US, they totally rely on what recommendation a grade 12 teacher is giving. They don't even wait for results, because they feel if you have put in 3 years of great studies, and if your teachers are recommending you that you're great, they trust the teachers. Here, what we are doing, 9th you may fail, 10th you may just get a 50%, 11th you just jump into some institute and do a rigorous study and all, and 12th standard you get one admission and there you are. But what's happening to the study which you have done in 9, 10, 11? That's the reason I said start thinking from 7, start thinking from 8. When you start thinking early, it's not about admission, it's not about career, it's about your passion. Yeah. Only now, if you look at me or yourself, we were not heading towards being a teacher, but we got into our passion, and that's the reason we are somewhere around, you know, trying to train teachers, get the students, because that's our call, that's our passion. And when you are driven by passion, you definitely find your right institution. Even abroad, if you ask in India also, all the Indian parents only know few Ivy League colleges. And they feel, okay, they are rated, they are having these grand numbers, and they are the best. No, that's not. You need to actually find a good counselor. You need to talk to your teachers, talk to the school, and whether you're doing a state board curriculum, if your passion is to go and study abroad, you can do it, provided you start early and do. And the ease of admission is making it so attractive for the students. They don't feel humiliated. They feel, okay, even abroad I can do my engineering. I need not just wait for my GE results.
Correct.
Second is more study options. Thirdly, the quality of education, the research and development. That is something which we need to develop. Why we need to only do what others have already discovered. Why can't our students do some research? And some of them, I mean, I get very excited when my students used to actually create something.
Yeah.
Now, this is something we need to push. The insecurity of the job in India is making the students all the more tense. That's also the reason. Because they always think they have to do engineering, there is commitment at home, and they have to get a job. Otherwise, what are they supposed to do? That's the biggest issue, the insecurity of job. And that again goes, you know, we are trying to not blame, but we are saying a lot of opportunities have to be taken, you know, opportunities have to be found. And even we have to see that we take up these opportunities and build some kind of industry, or try to be an aspiring risk taker to actually develop something and do on your own, instead of just following the rat race.
And when you talk about research, I think I wanted to touch upon one topic, one point there, is that when we talk about our universities and colleges, I feel that the research is more academic, right? It's not very industry-based. And that's also another big difference between our higher education and abroad, because there, the integration of industry into the universities and colleges, the programs that are introduced, I think is also one big advantage for students, pursuing
it. Absolutely. See, what happens abroad, the industry takes care and they want good students to come out. So they actually finance the universities. They give grants and they also give a kind of a internship programs and things for the students so that they can get the best brain. Here, our industries have started, but they are very slow. So what happens, the ground reality reality is very different. I still remember the economics which I read. I was still going on and on with the five-year plan. That has got nothing to do with the pragmatism of the day. The pragmatic approach of learning is not there. The industry part, and that's the reason international curriculum students do experience that, because they do that kind of learning where they're actually going out into the industry and doing research. See, doing research, when we say that, is also a skill. Finding out something is also a skill. Absolutely. And most students are very comfortable. If you have a lesson and you have the question answers given, they will learn. The rote learning is done and they can just give it back in the same manner.
I think that also we need to start so early on. It's not just that when you jump into the universities and colleges, all of a sudden you have to start thinking like that. If we start early on in our higher and middle school.
And I have seen you doing that. You're doing that. Pre-primary onwards, the focus should be of development of concept and skills. If that is done, then the decision making becomes easy, which college, which course, and where. I'm touching on the pandemic. See, with this pandemic coming, all of a sudden, students who had planned to go abroad, they actually were very disheartened, because they were not looking forward for just online classes. They were looking forward to an experience. Experience of the library, experience of the boarding facilities, experience of meeting international students. So I happened to talk to a few of them and I said, how are you people feeling? They said, ma'am, we are very miserable. The very first one, they were very miserable. I motivated them. I said, no, things will improve. But now, recently, when I spoke to them, they said, ma'am, there is a hope, because even though if they're doing online classes, the experience is wholesome because they're able to connect with the professors and the labs and everything online. That shows that adaptability is very high in the universities abroad. So that experience is there. Now, question is, what can we do to retain this brain in India? What I suggest is that a little more research has to happen in India. Now, a lot of curriculum is available in Indian universities, but they are not getting the right focus and direction. Now, I don't know whether you're aware, Ashoka University in last 5 years has done a real good job with liberal arts, with entrepreneurship, with history. Right. So the new universities are really coming up with good combination. And to name few, I think the private institutions which are coming with, 2 years of study here, 2 years abroad, those are good opportunities for Indian students, and we should actually lap it up. We should not just think of going abroad.
Yeah, but I think one big thing that can help, from our students to fly away and for us to retain that brain power would be definitely to upgrade our universities. And by that, I mean our professors. We need to upgrade their skill set, because I feel that, 25 years back when I graduated from college, and if I see the scene in colleges now, I don't see much of a change. I really don't. And in 25 years, if we have not been able to give a different outlook, different learning in our colleges, that's the very big reason for our children to fly away, because we need to change with times. And that will only happen if our educators in the universities upgrade their skill set.
If we want something at the top, it should start from below. The vertical planning has to happen. What is happening is we are very comfortable in our own boxes. We may talk about national education policy, we may talk about skill set, but who is going to change those skills are the people. So we need a massive training center where to train these teachers to actually make children think. And the outlook has to change. And the outlook can change only when we talk about what are the parameters, what are the differentiation, how are we actually going to look into the exam factor. Somehow I feel the examination fever, the kind of examination we are conducting, is not the right way. If we are thinking of having to retain this brain, then we have to bring a change there. One SAT score actually decides 200 universities in US.
Yeah.
And when they found that this was not correct, they said, okay, some university says we don't want SAT. We have our own methods. So they are investing a lot of time in selection of students. We are investing half a minute. Why I say half a minute? Why? You fill a form and that's it. And after that, you sit for the exam. If you qualify, you qualify. If you don't, you disqualify. Now that is the main issue. You cannot disqualify a student based on one exam. I am very clear, you need to see the progression. Apart from that, there should be different boxes. If suppose students are not getting into A university, the B and the C university should have almost the same quality. The difference should not be so much. Right now in India, you have the top universities and then you have nothing. Then you have nothing. There's nothing in between, and that is the reason for the exodus of the students to move. Think about the people who are staying in the B town and C town. For them, coming to Bangalore itself is like US. They're not even getting that. So there is a whole lot of things which we can say we have to be change makers. And we have to actually voice it out on the forums saying that we need to change the pattern, the curriculum, the learning, by also infusing how to study.
Yeah. And also I feel that as educators, like when we talk about upgrading our educators, I think the mentality of the entire society needs to be changing as well, because we need to look up to the teachers. I mean, another reason is that some of the best brains who can teach so well do not opt for becoming teachers or professors, because it's something that, oh, just a teacher. That, whereas I think it's the top cream, the educators are the top cream of the society, because they are the ones who are, you know, giving all the knowledge for people to go forward and become what they are.
Now, I'm at least fortunate enough to see two of my very bright students of a previous school who have opened a school in America of their own. So that gives me so much of pleasure that, you know, at least they have found their passion. Yeah. Brilliant students coming out of Ivy Leagues, and after doing their IB, they have actually opened school. And that too, very innovative, because that school moves from one county to the other.
Well, that's so
every 2 years.
Amazing.
And that's a really nice model. It's a pre-primary model, and they are just focusing on pre-primary and primary till grade 5, it will move from each county every 2 years. So what happens, they teach the skill sets to the teacher of the schools there, and then they move so that the learning remains. Brilliant idea.
Wonderful. So I wish they had something like that coming to India. Tell them, please, we need that.
Yes.
Sharing knowledge, sharing our skill set with so many teachers across the country, and that would benefit so many students.
This is something which we need to think. So when we talk about it, the other thing is, you know, the credential, overseas credential, just like, you know, in India, still now at least it is less. Otherwise, you know, anything which was foreign return was always given more value. Students still have that in the corporate sector. The overseas credential is given a better professional, you can say a Levi or professional success. If you take a master's degree abroad and come and join a corporate in India, you're definitely two steps ahead than the people who are here. That is also a reason for the students to move abroad.
Yeah.
Even after doing their IIT, they would like to take a degree from an Ivy League and come back, because they know it makes a huge impact on the position and the finance.
Correct. Correct.
How are we going to change is only going to happen when we have our universities also in the top 100 rankings. Sad enough, we don't fall anywhere.
Yeah. And we have the best brain power in the world, in fact. We have so many.
Education has not got that push. Yeah. The second what I feel is to retain them is involve students from an early age into, you know, what's happening around industry. Suppose a student has that, you know, acumen for business, then they should be actually working. 1/4 of their schooling should be in a firm. It should start from the school days, that 20 days out of 30 days, 1 week children should be made to work somewhere. Maybe that is going to change the skill set. Because in India, unfortunately, we are very good parents. We want to look after them even till they are 24. We will give their fees, we will provide everything, and that makes them very dependent. But if we instill this, that no, from 18, you need to look for a job for yourself, maybe the skill sets will improve. And then they start finding a call for the right job and the right, maybe they're very good at carpentry. Why are we not having vocational institutes? Very few are there. Why do I need to do a graduation to become a good carpenter? Where is the relation? Now what we do is, oh, carpenter. We don't even think that's such a high skill. We look down upon the skills. This change should be in the mindset. And more institutions, vocational institutions, should be open.
And I think that for schools itself, because if you start giving that kind of education in the schools, I think the children will also grow up with a wider thought process, and the respect for each and every person, the respect for each and every skill would be something that they grow up with, and the society needs to grow up with that kind of thought process.
If a child takes music as a son, know how tough it was for me to convince them that, look, they can still pursue music and do your dream engineering. Problem is, parents are dreaming from the shoulders of the child. That's wrong. You have to give wings to them. So when we talk about these, I mean, I'm really passionate about it, and I feel if I could only bring a change in the mindset of the parents, that look, if you want to do something, do the best, you can actually find a living out of it. The great insecurity, if it goes away, then I think we can let our children live their life and actually choose a profession, choose a college of their choice. Vocational colleges is something I feel India has to look deeply into it, because in Bangalore, if you look at it, in Bangalore, if I say, Sapna, can you tell me two art institutes? We have only two. We don't have more than two.
That's true.
Imagine for the population of in Bangalore, we have just two good art institutes, whereas we have more than 200 engineering colleges. Look at the spectrum. And 200.
And still our students are running away and finding happiness abroad, because the colleges, even though we have such a large number of colleges, the quality of education that our children are getting, they're still not happy with that. And I think somewhere that also speaks volumes, that we need to have somewhat something like an evaluation of teachers, of those professors, because in a lot of colleges, I've seen that there is a feedback program where the students who are graduating give a feedback on the professors. They don't want to.
Feedback of any system is known as a criticism. It's not progression. If you ask me, feedback should lead to progression. But it takes, people take it very personally.
Right.
Now, in the international curriculum, we say why the quality is good? Because they have a review system. You're aware, every 5 years, there's a review. And it's not the review of a particular A, B, C, D. It's a review of the philosophy, of the policy. Same thing has to happen. We need to do that to all the colleges, so that, you know, the colleges are always under a scanner thinking, if my quality dips. But somewhere, you know, I feel even if we have rules, implementation is an issue. Secondly, nobody is taking the risk of firing people if you're not good.
Yeah.
That comfort that if you're in a government job, it's like, okay, every month I will get what I'm getting, whether I do my job, I do. The responsibility and a kind of, you know, roles and rights and responsibilities are not defined.
Correct.
And there's nobody who can actually reprimand. Yeah. Once in a while, you'll find somebody getting suspended, and after 6 years, again, they're back. So when we talk about colleges, it's only if you ask me, quality.
Yeah.
If you give quality education, why will students leave the comfort of their own home and go abroad? They will not.
Absolutely. And also for the parents, because the parents are supporting those decisions, because they themselves feel that, like, for 25 years, if they're still studying in the way I studied, where is that newness that the children need to learn with and because the whole world is in such an extensive globalized state, and we need to give them new ways of learning, new ways of thinking, new ways of, you know, experimenting with things.
Sapna, these are the parents who are actually interacting on a global platform, and they are actually passing out their experiences. They're saying, oh my God, if I would have done something abroad and come back, I would have been at a higher position. So why should I not pass it on to my children? They are ready to sell their land, their house, everything to send the child abroad because they feel that is going to bring back professional success for them.
And if we upgrade, I think if we upgrade our universities, we start paying our professors better, we have this evaluation system in place, it would still not cost the parents as much as they spend when they send their children abroad. And if we can just get us basically a system in place to upgrade our education in the higher studies in the universities and colleges, I think.
Absolutely. Because very few students are just going for the heck of it. Most serious students are actually going, staking a lot on their head. You know, they're going with a tension on their head that there's so much of liability back home. Parents are actually paying those fees, and I have to at least return back with some kind of earning. They're not going just to spend and while away their time. No. Now, it is most of the upper middle class who are actually working class are taking that money and giving it to the child. Why? Because they want them to discover in a new way. The newness, the word what you have capped is absolutely apt, because you said the newness. And what is this newness? Because we are looking at 2040, 2050. What technology, AI, MI, all this will be there. Where will my child be if you are still doing rote learning? That is the fear, and that's the reason so many people are moving ahead. And if we have to retain them, then we have to improve our quality. We have to improve our quality from the Anganwadi stage, not at the college.
Absolutely. Like now that the national policy has come into play, we have to still wait and see when it is going to be implemented. Those things that we are talking about, when are they going to come into play? And but if we have more budgets for education, if we have quality institutes in place, I think we can definitely tap into this huge brain power that is running away.
Simple thing, Sapna, if we are spending so much on building a metro service, which is very much required infrastructure, we can spend 1/10 of it and have open libraries. We don't even think about it that students need that. In Bangalore, suppose a student is doing research, do you know where they go? They have only 2 to 3 big libraries, and it's sad. You are aware that only there are 2 to 3 big libraries, and to get the membership and make the students go there is also an ordeal for any teacher. So these are the little things which we have to do, and I'm very happy to discuss on it, because I feel discussions leads to a lot of interactions of thought processes, and somewhere down the line, someone will be listening.
True.
Something will happen.
Absolutely. And when you were talking about the pandemic, one thing came to my mind was like this year, whatever has happened with the students is okay, one story. But now the next year, how does it pan out? Because there will be students who have deferred their admissions going. There will be students who are applying new. And the universities abroad, definitely, they would also want to prioritize a little bit to their local students, because it's been a big setback for them. So how do you think our Indian students who are thinking of going abroad next year, what should
the
they...
The survey has given us some survey was done where they said around 68% students still want to go and pursue abroad. But the rest of them want to do at least 2 years in India, see how the situation is, and then move. And the reason for this is that is health issues. They're only worried, what if we go and if we fall sick in a foreign land, how are we going to manage? But the universities, on the other hand, have become very, very proactive, and they are now saying, okay, we will give you both the offers. Even in the schools, see how fast they have moved. They have opened the schools and they have said, okay, you have both the options, online, offline. So the design to say is, students have to make a very informed decision. Where are they going? What are the outcomes? are they able to achieve that being in India and doing online? Because for another 1 year, I somehow feel we'll be having online and offline both options. It's a very tough time, very stressful, because even the selection for the students to the university this year, they have actually eased out a bit. Some universities have also said we will not look into the SAT scores because they would not have the exams. So they are actually doing a lot, which is, you can say, more student friendly. So it is a good year to get admissions. But if you look at it on the other hand, it will be online and offline, both options. So you can't be thinking, I got admission, yay, and I'm in that land. No, you may still be continuing in India for a certain period of time.
Absolutely. And I think that negates the basic reason that they want to go, is for the experience and to learn in a different way, which is probably not going to happen somewhere very, very soon.
If you ask me that, ma'am, what is your call? I would say save penny. Save your 2 years. You have all the paperwork. Join an institute in India. You can always again apply as a transfer candidate after 2 years. Why not do that? Experience things in India, at home, have that family bonding, because a lot of students are now discovering that family is not so bad. They're actually all the time at home. So they have realized. And I think if they think of going abroad, then they have to be very sure which place they are going, what kind of health facilities are available, at what cost. That's also very important. Cost is a very, very driving force at this time. With the economy, the way it is going.
Absolutely. It's a very tough time for whether you are studying in India, whether you want to go abroad. I think everybody is in a very, very tight spot. And but I think it was great hearing all your views. And I'm sure the students also got a lot of it. But I think the basic thing that we all agree upon is that we definitely need to upgrade our education system,
absolutely,
the schools and the higher education. If we really want to retain, we need to improve the infrastructure. We need to upgrade the skill set of teachers. We need to give our children that freedom to choose those subjects, balance their curriculars with the extracurriculars, so that they get what they are running for those universities abroad. They get it right here, then why would they go? So,
and the complete makeover of the complete education policy.
Absolutely, absolutely.
You have a policy, but you need to do a makeover so that everybody feels happy doing that. It's not a burden anymore.
Absolutely.
Nice talking to Sapna. It was a nice kind of a brainstorming of what has to happen.
But I'm sure soon in the years to come, something would, happen with all these thoughts going, and we would see our colleges and universities up there in the top ranks. So
absolutely looking forward to that.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.